the next question is, we have to think about how we're going to negotiate with people. Are we going to negotiate publicly or privately, separately or together? So the first one we're going to look at is a quote by a Swedish company which decided to do a private negotiation because they figured out that if they did a public negotiation, they could have some problems. So in this case, they said, I should say here, no choice. They had no choice but to do the negotiation secretly and quietly. This is a quote from the CEO of the company. There were no lawyers, no auditors, no environmental investigators, no due diligence. We tried to value assets as best as we could, but we were absolutely convinced of the strategic merits. Why the secrecy? Think of Sweden. It's industrial jewel, ASEA, a 100-year-old company that had built much of the country's infrastructure, was moving its headquarters out of Sweden. So this is the problem, right? Very traditional Swedish company, also like Volvo, was moving to another country, moving its headquarters to another country. They were selling it to another country. So the news came as a complete surprise. There was a shock. Do you understand fait accompli? Fait accompli means they present something as a fait accompli, means that you already made the agreement. You already did something, and then the other people have to adapt. So when I was working before, one of my co-workers, he used to use that strategy a lot. He would just do something without telling me, and then he would present it to me as fait accompli. Fait accompli means it's already been done, it's already been finished. And then, of course, I wouldn't be happy that he did it like that. Did I have any choice? No, it's already finished, right? So he used that kind of strategy. He would just do something, and then later he would deal with, I would complain or give out, and then he would have to deal with that problem. So they did this kind of way too. They made a deal with the foreign company, sold the 100-year-old Swedish company to a foreign company, and then told the press at the end. Okay? They think that at the end they have to win over the shareholders, the public, the governments, and the unions. Have you ever done that? Have you gone and done something that you knew the other people wouldn't like? And then afterwards, you try to win them over, that you were correct. Did you ever do that? Just go and do something that other people don't agree with, and then try to convince them later that it was a good decision. Or you try to convince them first. So it depends on the situation, right? In this case, they decided to do that, and then later they were going to win over the public, the government, the unions, and other people. Another one is when we have two parties. Should we negotiate with them separately or together? So this one you might understand. So we can get dad to say yes. You can tell your dad. Mom said yes, this is untrue. Okay, and then you can go to the other room, to mom, and say, dad said yes. Okay, ask for permission. That's also untrue. Okay, so dad might say yes because mom said yes. And mom might say yes because dad said yes. Okay, and then by the time the parents get around to talking to each other, comparing the story, Junior has already left with the car. So Junior wants to use the car, right? So he tells dad, mom said I can use the car. Okay. Then he tells mom, dad said I can use the car. Are you okay? Then both of them say okay, then he can use the car. But if he negotiates together with dad and mom, they're going to say no, right? So Junior's strategy was to negotiate separately with dad and negotiate separately with mom. Yes. Okay? Do you do that strategy?
Yes.
With your mom and dad?
Yes.
You do?
Yes.
For example,
I want to buy an expensive, expensive goods.
Mm-hmm.
It's very expensive, so I want. I said that I want this gift. So, it's very expensive, but I pay separately. So, if you help me, I ask mother, mother to buy this product.
Ah, okay. So you want your dad to convince your mother. Okay, so you're doing a little bit like this one here, where you're backward mapping. The most difficult to persuade player is your mother.
Yes.
And then you could have on board your father. Your father can help you to initiate negotiations with the target. Your mother is the target.
Yes.
Right, so that's in this case here. Okay, so it may be the same with different companies, right? It may be better that we don't have to share all the information between the two companies at the same time. We can negotiate separately with one company and then negotiate with another company separately. We already talked about the Budong-san, right? They often tell you that, oh, the other party is very interested in the house, they're willing to pay an extra money, that kind of thing, right? And they negotiate separately. If they have the two people in the same room together with the Budong-san, then the people might decide to cooperate instead of competing. But the Budong-san wants to make them compete. So sometimes we have to decide about whether negotiating together or separately. So here's another example. So influencing whether a negotiation happens before or after one's own negotiation, as well as whether its results become public, can affect the outcome. So for example, the United States was in separate talks with Japan, Hong Kong, and Korea over textiles. Do you understand textiles?
Yes.
Some clothes, clothing industry. A Korean negotiator announced that Korea would wait for the other Asian negotiators to go first. Okay, then after waiting for Japan and Hong Kong to go first, Seoul asked for all of the things that Japan and Hong Kong got, and they also got some more. So in this case, the sequence was important to Korea. They wanted to go last in the negotiation. If they're last, they let them do the hard work. They just get the same things that Hong Kong and Japan got, right? It's not fair if the US don't give them the same things. So Japan and Hong Kong have to work hard to get the deal, and then Korea says, I want the same as that, and I want this too, or no deal, right? So Korea used the sequence in this time to get an advantage. So do you have any questions about the sequence? Sequence of negotiation, it means when you do the negotiation or together or separately. Okay. We use the backward mapping and looking at the parties. No question? Yes?
Separate contract. So contractor hide the option in this contract. Hide?
Yes, that's a good question about ethics. Can you give the false information to the other person? Is that allowed? What do you think? If I'm a Budong-san, am I allowed to give somebody a false information if I'm negotiating separately? Can I say that the other person has agreed to pay $200,000, even if that's not true? Can I say that or not? Legal or illegal? That's illegal, right? So you can't. Some things we are going to deal with later in the course. We're going to do some part on ethics. We'll talk about it in more detail. But some things is called fraud. Fraud is like giving the wrong information like that. Right? Fraud. Purposely giving the wrong information. okay? But you don't, it's just like the philosopher Kant said, if somebody comes to your house and they're going to kill you, or sorry, they come to your door and they knock on the door and they ask, where is your father? And they have a gun. They look very angry. They're covered in blood. What are you going to say to them? Your father is in the living room. What are you going to tell them? This is a philosophical question. So discuss with your partner. What are you going to say? Some guy comes to your door with blood and a gun and your father is in the living room and they say, where's your father? They're sweating a lot. They look very panicked. Right? What are you going to say to them?
Hear it too.
So discuss with your partner. What are you going to tell the guy? Okay then, what are you going to tell? Guy, the door. He's in the living room. Just here. You don't know where he is? Liar! He's in the living room. Right, so you would tell a lie in that case. Right, anybody else?
Ask why you want my baby.
I'm going to shoot him. What are you going to say next? Where is he? What are you going to say next? So, the philosophers were making fun of Kant because Kant said you should never lie to people, right? But how did Kant answer this question? He said, you just don't have to lie. You can just give evasive answer. Evasive answer like, oh, he was in the kitchen a while ago. Do you understand evasive? So, or you could say, I saw him in the post office 4 hours ago. Is that a lie?
No.
No, you did see your father in the post office 4 hours ago, right? It's evasive answers. So Kant says that you don't have to directly lie. So fraud is a little bit similar to what Kant says. If you directly give them the wrong information, that's fraud, okay? But if you are evasive, you don't have to tell them the truth. Okay? Do you have to tell the guy at the door the truth? Kant says, no, you don't have to tell him the truth. Your father is in the next room. But you can tell him some evasive information. So we'll look at that later in the course, but similar with fraud. Okay? So you can say, you could say, instead of saying the person is going to pay $100,000 for the house, right? You can just say, I have another person who's very interested in the house. They're prepared to pay a lot of money for the house. Okay? If you're not purposely telling them exactly the wrong information. So we'll talk about more. Different people have different ideas. Okay, even the philosopher, like Kant and different philosophers, other philosophers say in that case, it's okay to lie. It's okay to say, I don't know, or he went to the shops. Okay? So, any other question? So then, we talked about the sequence, let's talk about the process. So we're going to talk about today alternative dispute resolution mechanisms, mainly mediation and arbitration. So here is some ADR, alternative dispute resolution. So alternative dispute resolution really is when negotiation doesn't work. So we want to negotiate with the other side and negotiation is not working. So what other process can we use instead of negotiation? It's called alternative. We have a dispute, we want to resolve the dispute, so alternative dispute resolution, mediation and arbitration. So we're going to look at the corporate pledge, screens, contract clauses, online dispute resolution, arbitration and mediation. So the first one is a corporate pledge. So, do you understand pledge? What does pledge mean? What does pledge mean?
Promise
or swearing, right? So we basically, our company swears that if we have any problem with negotiation, then we are going to use ADR before litigation. Do you understand litigation? Litigation is the worst case scenario. If negotiation breaks down, what other process can we use? We can go to court. Okay, but before we go to court, we can use mediation, arbitration, so on. So we make a pledge, a promise, which says that our company is going to try to use these techniques. Now, why is that important? The reason is that reactive devaluation, another psychological problem. So if we're in the middle of a dispute with another company, and we say to them, well, let's try going to mediation to resolve the dispute. The other person might think your position is weak, okay? Or your proposal might be devalued because you want to go to mediation. You say, let's try mediation. Okay, then they say, you're weak, and they feel stronger in their position, right? But if you have a corporate pledge, which says it's your company's policy to go to mediation, there's not this psychological issue. You just tell them, it's our company's policy to try mediation, okay? Then they don't see you as weaker in that case. So many companies these days make this kind of pledge, especially in the US. Screen is a list of questions. Based on these questions, you decide whether to do a binding or non-binding ADR process. So the question is, discuss with your partner, what is a binding process and what is a non-binding process? What's the difference between binding and non-binding? What do you think? Do you understand binding in English? Yes, pulling things together, binding things together. Okay, so which of these is binding and which is non-binding? Litigation? Binding. Arbitration?
Non-binding.
Mediation?
Non-binding.
Negotiation?
Non-binding.
So what does it mean, binding?
Legal process.
You have to accept the decision, right? In negotiation, do you have to accept the decision? Or do you have a choice? Mediation, you also have a choice, okay? In the court, if the judge makes the decision, do you have a choice? Can you say, sorry judge, I don't like that decision? I don't think I'm going to accept that. No, you don't, right? Arbitration is the same. Okay, Okay, so if you can decide which is better for your company, binding process or non-binding process.
Non-binding.
You can decide. This screening is a list of questions which helps you to decide which is better for you to use, which process is better. Okay? Another thing we have is contract clauses. So we just say in contract, when we make, this is very common in the United States, when we make a contract with another company, we say in the contract, we're going to go to mediation first if we have a dispute. After this, we're going to go to arbitration. After this, we're going to go to litigation. So normally this is the process. We start with negotiation, this doesn't work. Okay? Then we need to look at ADR. These are ADR. Okay? So we think about next, mediation, doesn't work. Arbitration, then litigation. So that's normally the way it goes in a contract clause. Online dispute resolution, this is less effective because in mediation we get to meet the person face to face, build a relationship. Online dispute resolution is getting popular for small disputes because it's very cheap and convenient. Here's an example. So most of these involve like everyday situations. So if you have a problem with your landlord or your somebody who's living in your house together, right? You can get some online dispute resolution. You put your problem in and then they give a suggestion to solve your dispute. So for example, the landlord is billing me and my roommates for some damages we didn't cause. Do you understand damages? Right, broken window, broken screen. We live in a bad neighborhood. So maybe some drunk guy kicked in the window and screamed, right? But the landlord wants to bill us. The landlord insists we caused the damage, right? So it's a dispute between landlord and tenant. So maybe it's not worth paying the money for the proper arbitration or litigation. So we just go online, and in the US you can do online dispute resolution. Both of you make your argument online, and then they send the solution, what needs to be done, and you both, then you can decide, it's like mediation, right? You can decide whether you accept the suggestion or not, or you're going to go further. So then, let's move on to arbitration. So you might not know, but arbitration is in a lot of your everyday transactions. So for example, have you ever used online shopping? Yes? So when you click on the terms and conditions on the online shopping, you're agreeing to some arbitration if there's some problem or dispute, right? So Amazon, eBay, also insurance company, if you have an insurance contract, also in the terms of agreement, there's some arbitration. So if you have a dispute with the insurance company, they're not going to pay for your insurance claim. You didn't read the small print, but you're going to go to arbitration first before litigation. Okay? So we can find this in everyday life. Arbitration is basically, we're going to have a look at video so we can get a good idea about what arbitration is. Video is a little bit long, but it will help us to understand well about arbitration. Okay? So arbitration is basically, it's like a judge, a private judge, just for us. There's no jury or no public, it's private. The judge doesn't have to be a lawyer, they can just be an expert. There should be an expert in that area. They listen to our case and they listen to the case of the other side and they make a decision. It's going to be cheaper than going to court. Why is it cheaper than going to court, arbitration? This is cheapest, cheaper, more expensive, most expensive.
Because the litigation is charged for losing.
You could also have a charge if you lose in arbitration. You have to pay the lawyer's fees, right? But you can also have a lawyer in arbitration, but the lawyer's fees will be much higher for going to court, right? Because in the court, there's a lot more so-called discovery. Discovery is when the lawyers look through all the papers of the other company, try to make their argument. So in the court, it takes a lot more time. The lawyers have to make a lot more effort than in the arbitration. Okay. And in court, takes longer. Takes a longer time period. The one thing is, you don't have to pay for the judge. The judge is free for the court. For arbitration, you need to pay yourself for the judge. So that's a lot of cost, extra cost for arbitration. So let's have a look at the video. So we have a dispute between the owner of some real estate and a contractor. Do you understand contractor?
Yes.
What does contractor mean? What is a contractor?
A person who has a contract.
Yeah, so for real estate, what would a contractor be?
House owners.
The house owner is the person who owns the real estate, and then they hire the contractor. So what does the contractor do? Or what kind of things would a contractor do? Contractor is just working for them, right? They could be breaking down some part of the house, rebuilding the house. Okay, that kind of things. So the owner hired the contractor to build a building. Okay. The problem is, after the construction started, the owner made some design changes. As a result, the contractor is claiming an additional $55,000 for the design charge of changes. Okay. Also, there is a subcontractor. What is a subcontractor? Yeah, so the contractor hired a subcontractor. They did plumbing work. Do you understand plumbing work?
Yes.
What is plumbing? How do you say plumbing in Korean?
Pegons.
Okay. They also had to make more changes, and this cost an additional $95,000. The owner has refused to pay. The owner says that he claims that they already should have known about the design changes. Okay, so they have a dispute about that. Do you understand this dispute, more or less? The contractors say that they need to get more money because the owner changed the design, and the owner says, no, I don't need to pay any more money. Okay, so you're going to answer the question. If you were the arbitrator, how would you decide the case? So you have to pretend you're the judge in the case. Listen to the two sides. It's a little bit like negotiation, right? But negotiation with the third party, third person, the judge there. So the judge is going to help to make this. So this video is on the internet course. We mentioned we're using this internet course too, right? You signed up in the room. So
didn't you tell me that the arbitrator is a lawyer? I'm concerned that we won't be able to understand what I'm trying to say, and that could jeopardize the whole arbitration.
Yeah. If what I understand is that you want, they make sure that we have an arbitrator who's knowledgeable about construction.
Yeah.
I agree. Mr. Hoffman, though, he's well qualified in that regard. He was educated and he worked as a construction engineer before he ever became a lawyer, and his law practice has been concentrated in construction, and he is an experienced arbitrator. So that's why we put him number one on the list of potential arbitrators that the AAA gave us.
Well, as long as he understands construction, I feel comfortable.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Steve Van Leer, the American Arbitration Association's Tribunal Administrator on this case. It's nice to meet you all face-to-face after talking so many times on the telephone. You've all met David Heilbron, the arbitrator. So at this point, I'll turn it over to him. Mr. Heilbron?
Thanks very much, Steve, and good morning to everybody.
I understand that the subcontractor has a claim against the contractor, and the contractor has a claim over against the owner. I've read each of the claims and the answers to them, so I'm generally familiar with where we're all starting from. I also understand that the subcontractor has a contract with the contractor, contractor has a contract with the owner, and that each contract has in it an arbitration agreement. But that since all claims arise out of the same set of facts, everybody's agreed to arbitrate both claims together. So thanks for that, and we are ready to go. As you know, this is an informal proceeding. The formal rules of evidence do not apply, and the basic rule is just common sense. So you should stick to the point and the facts that count, so we get to the meat of it all quickly and we move along. And I know you all do that. Now, I understand last that each of you has an opening statement that tells your view of the case, and that will be very helpful. So, Ms. Crittenden, for the subcontractor, if you'll start first, the claimant, and then the contractor, Mr. Madison, and finally the owner. We're ready. Please proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Hoffman. As you know, I represent Mead Mechanical, the plumbing subcontractor in connection with this project. Mead Mechanical had a contract with the general contractor to install all of the plumbing fixtures in the building. We received a work schedule from the general contractor and were well underway in performing under the contract when we received a stop work notice from the owner as a result of design changes proposed by the owner. At that point, we got our crews off the project, got them into other jobs, and waited for the design changes to be delivered. Once we received those, it was apparent that we had to go back in and redo a lot of the work that had already been done. The cost of this additional work totaled approximately $95,000. Nevertheless, we went back in, we got the work done in accordance with the new plans and on time, and submitted our bill to the general contractor. From that point forward, we have received nothing but delays. We have not been paid. Apparently, the owner is taking the position that he is not responsible for these charges because none of the work would have had to have been redone if the original work schedule had been complied with. For his part, the general contractor tells us that he had the right to vary that work schedule and in fact had the right to be ahead of schedule if that was necessary, and that he also discussed all of this with the owner before the design modifications were actually implemented. We don't really know or care whose position is correct. We simply want to be paid for the work which we have already done, and that is why we've initiated these proceedings.
Thank you, Ms. Crittenden. Mr. Madison, will you please call your first witness?
Yes. As our first witness, I'd like to call my client, Mike London, of London Construction.
Mr. London, please raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes, I do.
Thank you. Mr. Madison, please proceed.
Mr. London, would you please explain to the arbitrator the substance of your agreement with the owner, Mr. Baker?
Yes, it was not a complicated project. I agreed to build Mr. Baker's building for him. It was an office building for a lump sum price. My price was based on the plans and specifications that he furnished us prior to bid.
Did you begin the work?
Well, yes, we were given a notice to proceed and we started on the project right away with the foundations. Our subcontractor, Mead Mechanical, was also doing some of their preliminary work and their pipe chases, which are in the foundation.
How did the work progress?
Well, we were well into the subcontracting submittal phase and we were in good shape with respect to our schedule.
Did any delay occur in the work?
Well, we gave the owner our schedule and we were beating the milestones on that schedule when Mr. Baker called us on the telephone and told us to stop work because he was redesigning some of the work.
Mike, this is Bill Baker calling. I wanted to let you know that I've decided to make some structural changes on our building, and we'll need to stop work for a while until we get it straightened out.
Bill, you know that we started on the foundations and the mechanical subcontractor has got some completed work out there as well. I think based on our job lock last week, Mead has about 35% of their roughing done, and we're forming and pouring the first half of the grade beams. Anyway, I know that if any of your changed work affects the work already completed, it's going to need some extra costs, and it's going to have to be for your account.
Well, Mike, the changes really shouldn't affect the work in place that has been done as the schedule shows. But in any event, if there's a problem, let me know what the cost will be.
Oh, I will, but I'm concerned that if the redesign takes any length of time at all, it's going to be a delay and extra costs. I've scheduled some heavy mechanical equipment to be delivered, and my labor agreements are coming up in June.
Well, I really don't think that we'll be held up too long, but in any event, you let me know, okay?
Okay, I will.
It was almost 4 months since my conversation with Mr. Baker that we received the revised drawings and structural changes. Of course, we took the revised drawings and forwarded them to our subcontractor, Newton Mechanical. But the structural changes required a substantial amount of the plumbing and mechanical work, which had already been done, to be ripped out and redone. For instance, it required changes in the locations of the blockouts, grade beams, and so forth. It was almost 6 months since the owner told us to stop work that he ordered us to resume work. In addition to our subcontractor's claim, we incurred extra costs in the area of extra supervision and coordination of the work.
Well, would you please tell the arbitrator the costs that you incurred as a result of the six-month delay and the changes that were made in the work?
I have prepared a record of our labor and material costs. It itemizes and breaks down our extra costs in the area of extra supervision, remobilization, and escalation. Not including me, Mechanical's claim, our claim and extra costs amounts to $55,000.
Mr. Harbin, as the contractor's next exhibit, I'd like to submit this summary of the costs that were incurred in connection with the delay and the changed work. I've already given a copy to Mr. Hogan, the owner's lawyer.
And I would simply like to note that this is only a record of claim costs and has no bearing on my client's liability.
Well, I appreciate that. I'm sure we all do. And of course, you can cross-examine to the extent you want with respect to the costs. Now, Mr. Madison, do you have any more questions?
I have no more questions of this witness.
Fine. Mr. Hogan, please proceed with cross-examination.
Mr. London, after you had begun work on this project, you were aware, were you not, that structural redesign was being considered by the owner?
Well, I seem to recall hearing something like that, but never anything from Mr. Baker.
Well, regardless of the source of these rumors, you were aware that redesign was being considered, correct?
Well, as I said, I heard rumors, but it was a long time after I first heard them that Mr. Baker said anything to me. In fact, I'm sure it was not Mr. Baker who first told me about the structural redesign.
Wouldn't it have been easy for you, sir, to call Mr. Baker and find out whether or not the rumors were true?
I suppose so.
Don't you think that you, as a prudent general contractor, had a responsibility to call the owner and find out whether redesign was being considered?
Well, I am a prudent general contractor, but I'm not an architect or an engineer. I simply build the project according to the plans and the specifications that the owner gives us, and it's up to him to make any changes that he wants to.
The work schedule that you have in front of you, sir, that is the one that you prepared and submitted to the owner in connection with this project, correct?
Yes, it is.
And this is the schedule that was submitted pursuant to the agreement between you and the owner for the construction of this office building, correct?
Well, that's what you say, but as far as I'm concerned, we were ahead of schedule.
You knew, did you not, sir, that the owner was concerned about the schedule and the time when the project would be completed?
Well, I knew that he wanted the building completed on time so he could start leasing the space and turning a profit.
Isn't it true, sir, that if this schedule had been followed, none of the work done by Mead Mechanical would have had to be redone?
Yes.
Thank you, sir. I have nothing further.
Mr. Madison, do you have any further witnesses to put on for the contractor?
No, Mr. Harbin, that's all we have at this time.
Thank you. And Mr. Hogan, are you ready to proceed?
Yes.
Then please put on your first witness and put on the owner's case.
Mr. Baker, please tell us about the reasons for the structural redesign work.
Well, the construction had barely gotten underway. I had a conversation with my architect who suggested some changes to the front entrance of the building which would have involved relocation of the public lounge area. I liked the idea. It would have improved the attractiveness of the building, so I told him to work up a design. When he did, I liked it and I decided to proceed. I immediately called the contractor to let him know what was in the works.
Hello, Mike. This is Bill Baker calling. We've decided that we're going to change the front entrance to our building, which may require moving the public lounge areas. Looks like you'll have to hold up any further work till we decide exactly what we're going to do.
Well, Bill, when we were out of the job last Friday, you saw that we had the foundations and some of the mechanical in place. I think that's ahead of my schedule that I gave to you. You're going to start moving things around at this point. You know there's going to be some extra costs, and I'll have to submit them to you.
Well, I can see what you're saying, but as I read the work schedule, which of course you submitted,
The work that you completed so far, in accordance with the schedule, shouldn't have to be changed, and there really shouldn't be any extras.
Well, Bill, I'll have to take a look at it, and I'll let you know as soon as I can.
Well, okay, Mike, you check it, and if you think there are going to be any extras, you let me know right away, because it may change the way I go on this.
Well, I'll take a look at it, Bill. All right.
Did you ever authorize any extra work?
Absolutely not.
I am in front of Mr. Hoffman.
Thank you, Mr. Hogan. Mr. Madison, would you like to cross-examine?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Hoffman. Mr. Baker, you understood in connection with this contract that you had the responsibility to notify the contractor if you were going to make any changes in the work or stop the work, isn't that correct?
Yes, I understood that.
And you understood, did you not, that the contractor had the responsibility for coordinating the work on the project?
Well, I mean, he was in charge of the construction.
You expected the contractor, did you not, to organize the work to finish the job as quickly as possible?
Well, I don't know that. All I know is that I approved the schedule which he submitted.
Wasn't it important to you to have the work done on time?
Yes.
Indeed, wouldn't you have benefited if this building had been finished ahead of time?
Well, certainly not the way it turned out.
There was nothing in the contract to preclude the contractor from finishing ahead of time, was there?
Well, not that I know of.
That's all that I have.
Thank you, Mr. Madison. And this witness concludes the testimony on behalf of the owner.
Thank you, Mr. Hogan. I understand that each of you has now put in all of the evidence orally and in writing that you want to put in, and that each of you rests. And accordingly, we'll take a break for a few minutes, and then after the break, you can all come back, and each of you can give a closing argument.
Thank you.
Mr. Halbrun, we believe the evidence in these proceedings demonstrates the following. At the early stages of this construction project, the owner began to consider structural redesign. Indeed, this was while foundation work was just beginning. This fact was known to the general contractor. Pursuant to the agreement between the owner and the general contractor, a construction schedule was prepared by the contractor and approved by the owner. Had this schedule been followed, the structural redesign would have had no impact whatsoever on this project. That is, none of Mean Mechanical's work would have had to be redone. During the discussion between the owner and the general contractor concerning the job shutdown while this redesign work was finalized, the owner requested the general contractor to advise if any extra costs would be incurred. The general contractor never advised the owner of any extra costs, and indeed, none were ever authorized. Since the contractor did not advise of any extra costs, any extra work done by Mead Mechanical or the general contractor should be for the general contractor's account. The owner should not be liable for any extra work done by either Mead Mechanical or the general contractor. Thank you, sir.
Mr. Halbrun, you've heard Mike London testify that he and the mechanical subcontractor had started work and were proceeding in accordance with the contract documents when Mr. Baker stopped the project. Unfortunately, the stop work order came so late that it impacted work already in place and was impossible to avoid extra costs. Yes, the contractor was ahead of schedule, but time was of the essence. And it's a central feature of a lump sum contract that the contractor have the freedom to reorganize the work as necessary in order to achieve maximum cost savings. This is what gives the contractor the incentive to give the owner the lowest possible bid in the first place. Mr. Baker's position is totally without merit. He gave clear oral instructions to stop the work. He expected those instructions to be complied with. On previous occasions, when he had made oral changes, those were paid for. He had an obligation to notify the contractor of changes in the work in a timely fashion. He was at the job on a regular basis and could see the progress of the work. And Mr. London told him that extra costs would be involved in the changes in the work and the delays. Mr. London has correctly interpreted his obligations under the contract, and both he and a mechanical contractor should be paid for the extra costs incurred.
Okay, you made your position very clear, all of you, and I'm very grateful for that. I think I have them well in mind. I've taken a lot of notes here, as you've all seen. I'd like a chance to review them, and of course I want to think about it. But as to the time of the award, the AAA rules do require that an award be issued within 30 days, and it will be, and I'll try hard to do it before then. So the hearing is now closed, and thank you all very much.
So that concludes our look at an arbitration and...
Okay, so we don't have time to discuss about that today, but once you can watch again in the home, and the next class we'll discuss about what's your decision? What decision are you going to make? And we'll discuss a little bit about the format of the arbitration. So this is in... We already signed up for this course. It's in week five, perform and evaluate, and here you can find arbitration. It's the 20 minutes here. Then go in about 5 minutes into the video, and you can find the video start if you want to watch again. So then let's finish there for tonight. Yes, but you also get the, here you have the cheapest option, web.com, see hosting plans. So you can go click on this one, top 10, and compare your hosting plans, find the best price. But this one I think is just the first one, it's just 50, only the first month, and then it's more expensive after that. So, you have to try and find some special offer, but they're quite tricky because they have a plan. The first month is very cheap, but the next month is very expensive. And you have to sign up for 1 year. This one here is $2. It says $2 a month. It has a star here, so we have to check the star. The introductory price is for the first term of service, so it means that just for the first month. So they just, if you do that, they will give you the website, so you can decide which kind of background and headings do you want. So usually they do this hosting and web design together. I can't find one. It's hard to find. You have to look through the prices. And see, this one is just 30 cents, but that could be just for the first month. So, let's check about the prices. Before this one, GoDaddy had the one which was $12 for 1 year. Some special offer. So sometimes they have a special offer. Here is GoDaddy's $1 a month, so $12 for the year. So this one here, I think is probably the best one. $1 a month. Then you choose your own domain name. write your name on here. That's available. So they want this is free. So you get this is $12 per year. So you pay this, right? And the domain name registration is free. So total is $12. You pay by credit card. Then you can start to do the website. So I think this is the best option. But you have to go to this first. Type in website hosting. Then this one here, top hosting sites. And then on the list, you can see this is special offer. Go there and choose your domain name. And then pay with credit card $5. And maybe the next year it might be more expensive.